Spielboys watching Stevie's movies. Spielboys watching Stevie's movies. Spielboys watching Stevie's movies. Spielboys.
Oh yeah.
Guess who's in the house, baby?
Oh, no. Oh, it's me and you in a house. I don't know.
Spielboys.
All right. You know, it's we're Spielboys and we're watching Stevie's movies.
Yes.
It's so elegant.
I'm one of your certified boys, Abe Epperson.
I'm a second, more journeyman, more apprentice boy.
Apprentice boy. That's not true. Don't sell yourself short.
I'm Tom Reimann, a Spielboy. Oh,
a Spielboy. We're so excited about this. And I want to take a moment and kind of tell you all about kind of the story of this podcast coming to be.
The tale of the podcast.
The tale, real quick, Tom and I used to do a podcast for another company. And that company, said goodbye to us. And we originally pitched that podcast, which was called The Cracked Movie Club. Mm-hmm. We originally pitched it as a Spielberg podcast, but they altered it just to do okay, every month you're going to do a different director. But we always have wanted to just talk about Spielberg ever since Tom and I have met. We kind of immediately clicked on, oh, are you a Spielberg scholar? Do you like to just read about Spielberg?
Are you and a we're like, yeah, boy.
Yeah. And turns out it was a match made in heaven. So here, and this is the product of that. This is the audio product of that.
That's a beautiful. That's a beautiful introduction.
Thank you.
Yeah. No, so now they all know. They all know the tale of the Spielboys, how they came to be.
Yes. Cool.
So why Spielberg? Yeah. Why Spielboys? Why Spielberg? I don't know.
I think you'll see a little bit of our, hopefully you'll see the charm of, us talking about it. We both really like the guy. Mm-hmm. He obviously, I think, for mostly boys of our age, was the guy. He crafted our childhood.
Yeah, everything I watched growing up was had his fingerprints on it in some way.
Right, rightfully so. He was famously called time and time again the Walt Disney of live action. And, everyone here listening has seen one of his movies, if not most of them, just because he's so important to culture. So we thought we'd do kind of not really a deep dive, but kind of an examination of who's the Spielberg guy? Let's take a movie of his and let's talk about how he makes his movies and kind of the behind the scenes and just who Spielberg is as a kind of Spielberg class of some kind, random tidbits that you might find interesting along the way of what made this guy so goddamn popular.
And it's specific, man, it was just for a 10-year stretch there. It was the 80s really that really minted him as just the guy.
Yeah. Yeah. And we're going to talk about some of his earlier films and we'll kind of get into the background of how he came to be as an artist. But we decided to choose one for this episode, our first episode, that is kind of more in the middle ground. But I like it because it really shows off a lot of characteristics of what makes Spielberg Spielberg. And so we chose for this one, 1991's Hook.
Yeah.
Not known as one of his best.
No, I think you can't say that this was his first flop because it wasn't.
It made way a lot of its money back, so.
It did. It made a decent amount of money, but it did not perform the way it was expected to. It is viewed by many as a flop, but it's not. It wasn't his he had a few missteps earlier in his career, but I think this might have been the first event film that he made that didn't connect the way that a Spielberg event film was sort of expected to.
Right. So I figure we should just get into it. And we have a segment now that we're creating, which kind of talks about the context and the background of where Spielberg was as an artist and just you know, the history of like where he was during these years in a segment we like to call Amblin' Man. Huh? Because he's ambling. He's going through life. And also it's you get it.
See, it's Amblin Pictures, and Amblin was the name of his short film. See, guys, it all connects.
We're killing it.
We're the best Spielboys. We're so good at it.
I just imagine us in a boat just cutting through the waves towards sunset.
Yep.
And the sun, of course, is Spielberg, and we're at full mast.
Yep. All right. I am indeed at full mast.
Amblin' Man, we're so excited. I love this. This. So let's talk about, the films before this? Like, what were, the last, three films he worked on?
The last three films would have been Empire of the Sun, Always, and Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade.
Which is interesting
because there's a middle chunk there between Temple of Doom and Last Crusade was mm-hmm. when Spielberg kind of tried to break away from his theme park, four quadrant blockbusters and try to make more, you know, smaller dramas like that. There's a stretch of three movies. It's The Color Purple, Empire of the Sun, and Always, which are small dramas. And I don't think any of them really did very well.
They didn't do and he had this. Like, going even back further, he had this notion of not wanting to be typecast. Like, that was very important to him.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll kind of examine how that went all along his career. But at this time, like, when he made Jaws, for example, in 77, it was like, oh... 75, sorry. Then he was like, oh, I don't want to be known as, like, a horror director.
Right, because he almost was. Like, he was getting horror offers after that.
And then a few years later, in 82, when he did E.T., he also felt like, okay, I have a lot of sci-fi ideas. I do like The Twilight Zone, but I'm a little worried that I'm going to become like that guy too. Like where I'm like, I think he had a lot of, he had a really good relationship with George Lucas. And he definitely, I think, thought that that was always his area, you know, like George Lucas definitely was sci-fi, always sci-fi. But, you know, Spielberg definitely was trying to do something different, trying to show that he had range. And so he made a series of, films like Always with Richard Dreyfuss. You know, like there's a lot of, I'm just going to make these smaller films,
very adult dramas, The Color Purple, Empire of the Sun. And even though Empire of the Sun's about a little boy, it's still adult ideas.
Right. And there's this phrase that I ran into a few times, reading about Spielberg, which is that several times in his career, he felt artistically stalled. And this is one of those moments right before Hook, where I think because he was talking about a lot of adult themes, we see the kind of introduction or the reintroduction, rather, if you really think of E.T. as a part of this, like, coda in terms of his films, where he wanted to kind of talk to children. He wanted to make a film for children, about children, you know, like, and he wanted to talk about themes that would, you know, be family-oriented and less, like, adult-specific. And I think that that's what Hook was to him, and that's why he took on this this project, because I think that he wanted to have kind of a return. I think he had his fill with some of the adult themes. He did come back to it, you know, in terms of, like, obviously he made Schindler's List, you know, there's Munich and stuff like that. He's always going to be playing with that. But the reason I think we chose Hook first is that there's something about, at least for the audience, for, you know, these two old Joes over here. I feel like there's something about his children's movies, and I think it's near and dear to what makes Spielberg Spielberg. And I think that this is him going, I want to kind of make a mark in that again.
Yeah, I think it's interesting. Well, I mean, we'll get into this a little bit in later sections, but he had circled a Peter Pan movie before this, and then walked mm-hmm. away from it. But I think. And again, we'll talk, this is more stuff we're going to talk about later, but like Hook is a movie about returning to your childhood in a lot of ways. It's a movie about nostalgia, which we'll discuss. But I think the reason why he's so good at speaking to children about, you know, he makes movies that are for children and about things that children deal with, it's the themes that he chooses to explore are really resonant ones. Like E.T. is a lot about like divorce, and like Hook is about, right, from the child's point of view, parents that don't when you're drifting away from your parents, like every kid experiences that as they get older. Mm-hmm. And so those are things that are always going to matter to you when you go back and watch them. So you'll still feel that connection to it. They're not emotions you grow out of. They're very profound emotions. It just because you're experiencing them as a child doesn't make them childish.
Mm-hmm. And in fact, I think that's one of the aspects of the Peter Pan, like kind of mythos, is that it is about like an adult reexamining what it meant to be like a boy. But all at the same time, now with age, having a different lens of like, oh, I can live vicariously through my children as well. And I think that he was dealing with that. Like, I can't remember exactly where he was as a family man at this point. This
91 is when this comes out. So he's got a few kids at this point.
89. So he's probably been kicking these around for a few times. And he really kind of goes for it. To be honest, it's one of those types of things where, like, usually in adult film, they really go for it. Like, I want to really hit the theme specifically. And we're going to talk more about some of the themes in the movie in a bit. But I just wanted to say, like, it is crazy how he, I think it's a part of him as an artist that he's going to really cut through. Spielberg really does, I think, consider himself a deep man. I think that, like, for example, in this movie, at one point, Hook whispers in Maggie and Jack's ears, maybe speaking of his Jack's parents, maybe before they had you, your parents were happier. I mean, yes, this is a film that very much is happy, perky, everything is bright and wonderful. But at the heart of it, there actually are some darker
kind of
thoughts.
There's darkness, there's pensiveness, there's a lot, it's very bittersweet. There's a lot of, and we'll get into that when we get to the themes, of course, but I'm glad you flagged that scene because that scene's really interesting to me. I mean, first of all, it's just a great scene, but Hook is very cynical about it, but he's genuinely cynical about it because at one point, I think the little girl Maggie says, "You're a liar," when he says that. And he's like, "No, I never lie." And you can take that as Hook just being the bad guy, but I think he really doesn't believe he's lying. He's like, "No, your parents obviously were happier before you were born, and this is why."
And I'm a very honest man. So, like, contextually, maybe I lie once in a while, but compared to your parents, I don't lie at all, which is kind of a complex thing.
It's a complex thought to introduce to children, and it's a thought you start to have at the age that Jack's at.
Exactly. That's the thing, is that I think Spielberg's so good because he can identify. This is something that is complex, but it's something that kids can, they understand. They can kind of conceptualize this. And I think that's kind of the magic sauce. He really does know kids. We're going to talk about it ad nauseum. So is there anything else you want to kind of talk about just to put this in context?
I think the only other thing to mention is I believe, and this is obviously, I don't know the man, but judging by some interviews he gives both contemporarily and then later on, like retrospectively about the making of Hook, I feel like this was a period of exhaustion for Spielberg, and it comes through a lot in the film. Like, this is a very imperfect film, and I'm sure we're going to talk about that. It has a few pretty big problems.
Regardless, $70 million budget, earned 300, got nominated for 5 Academy Awards. Still a pretty good outing for going.
Yeah, it's still.
Old
I love
Stevie.
That it lost. I don't know where else we'll talk about it, but it lost like production design to Bugsy, which is funny to me.
You know, the 90s is a hell of a time.
You know, that cultural touchstone, Bugsy. All it had to do was imagine Bugsy. Los Angeles 40 years ago.
40 years ago. Meanwhile, yeah, they're doing some of the biggest
builds. This was a monster build, which I'm sure we're going to talk about.
Yes, we will. But right now, I kind of, just because we're starting to creep into it, I feel like we can go to our next segment, yeah? And this one, we like to discuss the synopsis of the film, more or less, and, you know, let's get back into the themes and talk a little bit about the execution. This is mostly about the movie itself, what you watch and what you, you know, see and the interesting aspects of that. And this segment we call You're Doing It, Stevie.
You're Doing It, Stevie.
got it. It's taken from this film.
All
right.
Oh man. Well,
let's what's hook about? What's
your hook? You seen this? You heard about this?
You seen this? You heard about this?
You heard about this hook? All right. I'll sort of take the lead here. Okay. So hook. It's about Peter Banning. This he's a lawyer working for, you know, he does mergers and acquisitions, so he's like the modern day version of a pirate. And he's a family man that doesn't have any time for his two young children. We're introduced to him at a school play where his young daughter is playing Wendy in a version of Peter Pan, which is, you know, obviously it's foreshadowing, et cetera, et cetera. But he's on his phone the whole time trying to muscle through this $1 billion deal that he has to close before he leaves for London for Christmas. I think Christmas. It seemed, I've always assumed it was, oh yeah, there's a Christmas tree in that scene that Phil Collins is in.
There's a Christmas tree, yeah. It's not very Christmassy, but, you know, it does, everything looks magical in this film, so it, like, relatively, Christmas does not impress.
And I think it was,
because I think everything's,
it's just a whole lot of whimsy. And I think it was released in November, so it was like a holiday release, so, and I just associate this film with Christmas. It might not take place at Christmas.
It released in December, actually, early December. So yeah, it definitely was trying to go for the Christmas money, as he is wont to do.
Got
to
get them Christmas bucks, them Spiel bucks.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so he talks on his phone all through his daughter's play. He misses his son's baseball game the next morning because he has to go make this meeting. And his son very much resents him. Like, his son is older. Like, Maggie's the younger daughter. She's maybe 6 or 7. But Jack is like 10 or 11. He's getting to the age where he's going to start to have friction with his parents and start to be distant with his parents. And they have a very strained relationship. So they're flying out to London to meet Grandma Wendy, Dame Maggie Smith. who is, we learn that Peter was an orphan, Grandma Wendy took him in, and he's going there to help dedicate a new wing, I think.
I think it's the whole hospital.
Okay. They're dedicating a hospital to her and all the great charity work she's done with taking in orphans and raising orphans for the past.
Very old orphans, by the way.
Right. She must be like 150 years old.
She's like 150 because they're all 80. Her ancient orphans.
All these old, dusty old orphans.
Yeah.
They all stand looking like wizards.
Mm-hmm. But she's still like very, very smart, very quick. She sees right through Peter.
Yeah. Peter, he's so occupied with work. He screams at his kids. It's just a lot of, it's very clear that we're meant to understand he is completely absorbed by work and is neglecting his family. And at one point his wife takes him aside and she's like, look, we only have a couple of years where these kids even want us around. So
that's another like complex thought to throw at children, right?
Yeah.
I mean, it's like still family theme, but not even movies that are like talking about parenthood will examine it in that way or say it in that way. You know, they'll maybe like think about it, you know, but this movie straight up goes like, you are fucking this up. In like 10 years, they're not going to want to be with you. And that's like, holy
even
shit.
Even less time than that. Like Jack's 10 or 11. In 3 years, he's not going to want anything to do with you.
Exactly.
They're going to be teenagers. Exactly. And teenagers suck, man. They don't want you around at all. And then he goes to college and then it's over. Like, you've missed it.
Mm-hmm.
That is like heavy shit. Like, this movie throws, like, for the whimsy that we all sort of remember and have nostalgia for, there's a lot of like sad thoughts in this, and you know, bittersweet. Yeah. It's just because that's just life. That's what life is. But it, you know, it's part of the theme of the movie. So they go off to their dedication ceremony, leave the kids at home. The kids get magically kidnapped, magically abducted.
Yeah, suddenly and magically.
Very suddenly and magically. It's never really made clear how Hook is like spying on the real world and how he's able to easily travel back and forth.
He doesn't seem like he has, he doesn't have flying magic. He doesn't have a tink that can like crop dust him. You know, like, so did he get here in a boat that flies? Like, I don't know how he got up to there.
Yeah, we never see him in the real world, and they just kind of yada yada over it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So he abducts them and leaves a note basically saying, Peter's got to come back to Neverland and finish the fight that we started all those years ago, or else you're never going to see your kids again. So, you know, obviously they call the police because that's what you do. And Detective Phil Collins shows up, which I want to flag right away because this movie has some truly bananas cameos in it.
Yeah, yeah. Some more famous than others, oh man.
Like,
there's six Academy Award winners in this film.
And more than one musician. Insane. David Crosby is a featured pirate in this movie.
And it is perfect because he looks exactly like a pirate. I've always thought so.
He gets rocked in the balls by one of the Lost Boys.
Yes, he does.
Take that, David Crosby.
Crosby steals and smash. Yeah. God damn. What a time to be alive. What a set to be on. You know, cinematographer Dean Cundey is just sitting there capturing a shot of like, what'd you do today? I filmed a... Crosby getting kicked in the nads. Oh, what a life! What are you gonna do next?
I want to see the behind the scenes footage of that scene of them explaining. Okay, David Crosby, in this scene, we're filming the scene where your nuts get destroyed. Yeah. Your dick is gonna be annihilated by these plucky children.
Yeah. So the first AD walks over. So this is the boy that's going to be absolutely pulverizing your nutsack. Nice to meet you. Nice to meet you. Okay.
Leans over to the kid. Really liquefy it. Just really
go for it.
Really punish David Crosby.
It's like you. They all. Also, a lot of the kids are like. Some of them are newsies. Some of them are like completely different things. It's just a smorgasbord.
Yeah, one of them is a gangster.
Children. It's like, you got it. You got it, Crosby. I'll get right on it. Smash those nuts like you wouldn't believe.
Yeah, pummel David Crosby's nuts. We don't need them no more.
All right. So they call the police. Phil Collins shows up. They're like, yeah, what can we really do? And then Tinkerbell shows up. Maggie, Grandma Wendy explains to Peter that he's actually Peter Pan, from the stories, and she's actually Wendy, and that he stayed, and grew up because he fell in love with Wendy's granddaughter, who is his wife, Moira. But he's forgotten all of it.
Real, real kinky stuff.
Neverland has this sort of, like Lotus Eater quality to it, where it like your memory starts to fade the longer you're there, which is it
like pretty instantly. Like the more you remember it, the less you remember of other stuff. You know, it seems to be like almost one-to-one.
Yeah,
thing.
And that ties into the themes of nostalgia and looking back instead of looking ahead.
Right, exactly.
But so he kind of doesn't, like, he immediately is like, Moira, I think your grandmother's having a stroke.
Right.
So he goes up to the kid's room and starts getting hammered. Tinkerbell shows up and beats the shit out of him and carries him off to Neverland.
Right, yeah, basically. After he denies her a few times, she just says, you know what, fuck this shit. I'm going to just take you straight to Neverland and let's solve
this thing. Just carries into Neverland wrapped up in a sheet. It's very funny.
And she takes them directly. I guess I at this point, Tinkerbell thinks, played by Julia Roberts, thinks that, you know, like maybe Pan is still
like
there.
As soon as he gets the.
But she does. She does say at one point when she's like knocked into the dollhouse, like, you really have forgotten. So she is aware that he's not exactly himself. But she takes him directly to the Pirate Haven or whatever. And it's just like, take him to the Lost Boys. I guess what are you doing?
She's like trying to push him in the deep end.
Well, like, yeah,
one of the issues with this movie is that Tinkerbell doesn't really make a lot of sense.
Yeah, she kind of is at the whim of like just pushing things forward. They give her an arc that is kind of
very brief, to be honest, and not really set up or executed terribly well. She truly is. She only appears in scenes to nudge the movie along. That's like her function in the film.
Right.
But yes, for some reason, she drops Peter directly on Pirate Wharf, and he immediately gets robbed. So she has to beat the shit out of some pirates and then disguise him. He wanders onto Captain Hook's ship, and this is where we finally meet Captain Hook, who is played by Dustin Hoffman. It's a very, very fun performance. You know,
really
Dustin
good.
Hoffman's, you know, sort of he has some credible accusations of misconduct against him, so that stuff notwithstanding, it's still a fun performance.
Right.
And also Bob Hoskins as Smee, who is just delightful. He's probably my favorite person in this film.
Oh, he's
fucking killing.
He's the best. Just as I'm sure you have this story too, but I just think it's apt right now. Like, they're both actors. And so they were like really preparing, and you can really see it. They both have very deliberate things that they do. And at one point, both of them were like, oh, we get it. These guys are gay. We should play this up. And they go to Steven Spielberg and they're like, so we realize these guys are gay. And he straight faced to them said, this is a children's movie. They're best friends. And it's just like, I just think about, oh, okay, Steven, that's how Steven Spielberg's mind works. I see it now. You know, all these Shakespearean actors, really, you know, doing this, like, we are excited about a thing that we found.
They still
no,
do
shut
it,
the fuck
though.
Up.
And I've seen versions of that story where Spielberg interceding when it's like during filming and they're kind of really playing into it, and he finally has to say, guys, it's a children's movie.
Right. Yeah, that just tickles
it's,
me
it's,
that story.
Yeah, it's a delightful story about the making of Hook.
Just
but I mean, it's it comes
Let's
across
continue.
Like, yeah, they're yeah,
it does. They're very larger than life in terms of like their choices. Mm-hmm. So it fits pretty perfectly that they would like be in simpatico, you know, like they're both the biggest performances in the thing. Even more. And this is a film with Robin Williams. In
yeah.
It, so
Robin
like,
Williams.
You, know,
you see why they picked him, because his manic sort of rapid fire stream of consciousness is perfect for a hyperactive child. So when he does get into his Peter Pan mode, it works. But for most of the movie, he's very understated. Like, he's acting in this movie.
Very subdued.
He's a very subdued performance.
Fact,
so yeah, we meet Hook. He's sort of grandstanding to his crew. He's like, hey, I stole Peter Pan's kids. We're finally going to get to finish that war. He's going to be here any second. It's going to be fucking awesome. But one of you,
I was promised a
war.
Yeah,
he does.
I deserve this war with children.
Listen, when you're stuck in Neverland, all you got is stabbing kids,
man.
Yeah, so he's got to like, really make a meal out of it.
Man, the original story, real dark.
Yeah,
I can't believe we teach this to children. But you know, whatever.
But this is where we get the you know, the unforgettable Glenn Close cameo as the pirate who gets stuffed in the boo box.
You can barely tell. It's amazing.
I didn't know until a few years ago that was Glenn Close.
I had to read it like online or something at some point. Mm-hmm. You know, like, it was no way you could have told me, like, that's Glenn Close.
She's wearing a beard. I think she even has false teeth in.
She has false teeth. Yeah. She, you know, just so good at acting, is able to change the register of her voice. And, you know, it's just pretty cool.
Yeah.
Pretty cool stuff.
It's a bizarre cameo. I have no idea why she's in it, but it's one of the most memorable parts of the film. You know, it's the thing that people remember.
There were so many people stopping by, just like, I mean, we'll get into it later, but a lot of people stopped by because this is one of the biggest, like, literal productions around at the time, you know, just in terms of studio. There's a lot of people who are like, what's Steven Spielberg working on?
Yeah, can I get in there?
Can I get in there, you know?
So, yeah, he brings the kids down. They're in a net. And Peter immediately throws away his disguise, which is a good, you know, because of course you would. And there's a very, it's interesting. The scene is like both funny in that Captain Hook simply can't believe this is Peter Pan. Mm-hmm. There's one part where he's like, I'm Peter Banning and these are my kids. He's like, these are your kids. These are your kids. You're Peter. he really just can't handle it.
Yeah. Because it fucks up his entire plan, you know?
Yeah, it is. And it's, so it's both funny from that perspective, but it's also like, it's a painful sequence because Peter is so, I don't want to say pathetic, but it's close to pathetic. It's like he's trying to deal with this problem in the way that he deals with problems back home, which is just a lot of bluster and like, I'm a lawyer.
Well, he does the one unforgivable sin that you see in Neverland, which is he refuses to play.
Yeah.
And that's only at the like kind of midpoint where we see him play. Do we realize that like now anything can happen? And obviously, you know, your imagination can free your everything and your dreams and all that stuff that the film is good about. But until then, we have to kind of like pull Peter there. And that's kind of when Tink gets involved, because Tink kind of says like, yeah, that's not Peter, but give me 3 days and I'll give you a pan and you'll have your war.
Mm-hmm.
And that's when Hook is kind of like, okay, I'm down. So then we kind of have a ticking clock that you don't really feel, because like big steps are made very quickly as soon as, you know, Peter arrives in like, what do we call the land and the island in which the Lost Boys are?
The Lost Boy compound.
I mean, frankly,
they're like treehouse playgrounds.
Yeah, it's frankly
looks like a state fair.
It really does feel like a child cult, so I'm going to treat it as such. So he's brought there. He like finds his way magically. Some mermaids are involved, very hot mermaids that kiss him. You know.
In a very obvious pool. Like that's a rough sequence.
You know, I felt like Stevie's a little horny that day, I guess. Something, you know, they decided to make.
I get it. You want to have the mermaids in it because it's Peter Pan, but it's that sequence always felt so weird to me. I don't know.
It's just very. It's a big offer very soon. Happened over very quickly. But he like finds his way to the island, and like. Tink is there to kind of support him, but knows that in the end, nothing's going to convince the lost children, the lost boys, other than him actually just acting and being Pan. So
yeah.
She's more on the sideline saying, like, give him a chance and stuff. And all it really takes is one boy, as we learn. All it takes is one imagination. That's kind of one of the themes of this movie. For the children to kind of, they build the system where they draw a line in the sand and it's like, who believes who? And the first kind of iteration of this is like, Peter himself still doesn't believe it, but a little boy like plays with his face and decides, oh, I see, there you are, Peter. Like someone believes in Peter. And that starts to rally a few of the children to his side, but no one is really convinced that this is Peter Pan. There's a lot of work to be done, right?
Yeah, and this is also where we meet Rufio. We would be remiss if we did not mention Rufio.
who's the new Pan?
Yeah,
and this is the Rufio
song.
It's amazing. I wanted as a child to have his skateboard.
It's like a sail on it. He's cool as shit. Rufio.
Fucking Rufio, man.
He's the coolest. Like so even rewatching this movie as a 38-year-old man, I'm like, man, Rufio's the coolest.
Right. Like if karma's real and if I die and I become Rufio, like I fucking killed it.
Yeah, I nailed it. Thank you for this.
Rufio's cooler than all of us.
Yeah.
Rufio's the coolest. Even though he dies in this movie, spoilers.
He
gets murdered by Hook.
He kind of gets shafted. He's been taking care of these kids ever since Peter left them. Mm-hmm. And then he sort of just has to stand aside, even though Peter's just going to leave immediately again, and then he gets killed.
It truly is a horrifying purgatory for Rufio. Yeah. But there we are. Meanwhile, we're kind of intercutting these sequences as Peter's trying to get to know him, his old self. We have the loss of his children remembering him, and that is done via, a Hook's elaborate plan to... Maggie immediately.
Maggie's too young. Like, fuck, I think. Yeah,
she's too young. She's like, no.
I know my mom loves me.
I'm team dad. Yeah. I'm team dad all the way.
Yeah.
And but Jack, who's been having some issues, is starting to kind of turn to the side of the Hook, where it's like, yeah, my dad is a dick, all the way to the point by the kind of like near the end of the film at the climax where he's like, I am home. Who's this man? You know, like, so
yeah,
we really,
and he's dressed like Captain Hook at the end.
The kind
yeah.
of reversal of Neverland's magical power of becoming an adult and becoming a child, this kind of teetering of the scales in terms, and it's manifested by your memories and the way in which you act more like a child or more like an adult. And, you know, Hook represents the adult side of things, and Peter will eventually represent, or the Lost Boys, I guess, represent the children.
And I think Hook also represents that when you get to that point, at least Hook for Jack anyway, when you get to that age where you start to pull away from your family to try to find what your own identity is. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Absolutely. Absolutely.
So you start getting really into punk rock.
This movie really is about Peter and Jack. And
yeah,
like we mentioned the theme of reliving your childhood by connecting with your children. But for adults, I think kind of, as you said, it's about seeing yourself and your kid and being the adult you need to be for them to be children. That's kind of the, you get two childhoods, you get your childhood, and then you get reliving your childhood through living as an adult through your children, but you can't be a child anymore. It's done. That's kind of all the stuff is bottled up in this basic metaphor between what's happening to Jack versus what's happening to Peter throughout this. It kind of escalates. Like, what scenes do we, I want to speed along a little bit.
That's fair. I think the only,
what are the bits that make up Act Two? Like, we have the baseball game. We have
the baseball game's important.
Fight.
The food fight is important because that's when Peter finally starts to play.
Yes. And that's the first thing that really happens.
Yeah.
Which is, he gets super angry, and it's like, yeah, this whole spread that's nothing.
It's imaginary food. There's nothing to eat. Rufio's just fucking torching his ass, just dunk after dunk.
Oh,
and then
calling
him
mucus pea brain.
Like a, well, I was once like a pimple stained like finger band-aid. Like, he gets real gnarly with some of them.
Yeah.
And then so Peter starts hitting back and they start getting better. And he throws one out this time that I haven't caught before. He calls Rufio a prison barber, and I had to pause the movie.
I saw that this time too, and I hadn't seen it before.
I was like, oh shit.
I think it's the first time I watched it with subtitles, and I was prison barber.
Prison barber.
What the fuck?
I lost it at that one. The first insult he throws out, I think, is substitute chemistry teacher. And like, the kids kind of roll with it. They're like, oh yeah, that is kind of lame.
Right. But yeah, he gets there until he becomes equally as crass, but even more verbose than Rufio. Since he's the OG, he's the pan. Rufio just has the sword. And so that's like kind of the big, like, oh shit, pan's happening kind of thing.
So then they take him down to the wharf to steal Hook's hook, and that's the baseball game, which is when Peter, when it finally clicks with Peter that he is losing his son.
Yeah, and there's the little bit with home run Peter versus like run home Peter. And it's like seals the deal that he's like, Hook represents baseball there. He doesn't care, but baseball is winning. Because baseball is a thing that Peter wouldn't do with his son.
It's a very very simple but very important connection. Because to Jack, his relationship with his dad has come to be it's all contained within Peter missing the baseball game. So it's very monolithic for Jack. So anyway,
I did want to take this one execution bit on, because it'll come up time and time again in Spielberg. It's one of his superpowers. I want to demystify for people a little bit how Spielberg is, in a lot of instances, really effective at like getting you on the side of someone that you're supposed to be kind of in the middle of right now. Like, he's really good with that act two conflict. And one of the things that he does in the baseball scene is that he has off to the side Peter looking on and rooting for Jack, even though he has to be quiet. And that's something that Spielberg will do time and time again, is to kind of a very effective way to get the audience to, like, it's just the basic concept of dramatic mm-hmm. irony. We as the audience know something that other players in the play do not know. And by using this dramatic irony, he's essentially sealing the deal for us, going like, oh, he does love his son. It's genuine. It's authentic. We're there with that moment. But Jack doesn't get to see it, so that later he can unpack and make it so that it's like, don't you remember, audience, not Jack, I was this way when you were playing baseball. I'm your true dad. And if you feel vindicated, and it's this thing that Spielberg does in Act Two all the time, especially with his man-child characters, where it's like you're acting like a child, but you're a man, or vice versa. He does this a lot. He makes them kind of admirable. And he does this by kind of having an aside. It's kind of a Shakespearean aside of like feelings. He's like, oh, I'm over here having this genuine moment that we all find is endearing, but the reality is no one mm-hmm. else knows about it. I just want to notice that. It's like he does this all the
yeah.
time.
Yeah, for sure. So the big takeaway is the importance of this scene is like we said, Peter realizing he's losing his son. So he returns to the Lost Boys camp determined to fly. And that's when he realizes his happy thought is his children, specifically being a father. Mm-hmm. He starts to remembering everything that happened to him before in Neverland and rediscovering his ability to fly. He starts to forget about his kids. It's done pretty quickly, but it's there. So Tink appears one more time, embiggens herself to remind him that he's got to mm-hmm. go save his kids now. Like, this is not... You're not meant to stay here. You're supposed to go now that you've rediscovered this.
But she gets a little piece,
she does.
You know, before he yeah. goes.
We know, do, we do have to keep in mind, pan. Like from the original story, that Tinkerbell is in love with Peter to the point where she actively tries to murder Wendy a few times. Like, that's who Tinkerbell mm-hmm, is. Mm-hmm. She sends him on his way. He rallies the Lost Boys into one final battle against Hook. They storm the pirate wharf. Rufio is killed by Hook. It's not funny at all, but there's a scene where Peter's flying in there to try to get there in the nick of time, and he's not able to. Rufio has already been stabbed, and he kind of stops and says, no! Yeah. It's just like his delivery is no! very strange.
And wind, and the sudden wind that hits him, like there's like sails yeah. all around him, but like the wind is localized to just his face. It's a very cartoonish moment. It almost yeah. feels like Wile E.
Coyote. It does not land.
Which is something that we'll talk about yeah. more later, about how Looney Tunes influenced Spielberg more than you think. And that's why he made Animaniacs.
Anyway. So yeah, they fight. It's their big climactic sword fight. They fight down into the square where Peter wins, but he's going to just leave because his kids are like, please. Yeah.
Yeah, he shows him mercy.
Please don't murder a man in front of us. Like Maggie walks up and says, like, yeah. a very simple but powerful line that he's just a mean old man who doesn't have a mommy. Let's go. Yeah.
Right. It's very good. But I do like the idea that they're yeah. very, they dance around it. They're like, yeah. you know, let's just
maybe
go.
Maybe you don't stab a man go? To death in front of your children.
Because you definitely think he's going to kill him, because he is dead set on, like, you're gonna do this to my children because you're yeah, an eternal
you're just
demon.
A bastard.
So I gotta nip yeah, this motherfucker
we gotta
in
take
the butt.
This dude out.
Yeah, do you think Jack's gonna become the next Pan? Hell no, he's gonna go to fucking Harvard, you know. Like, I am where the yeah, buck stops.
I'm taking
you gotta
out.
Go.
I'm not luckily, getting back to London only to have to call Phil Collins back to my house to investigate another kidnapping.
Luckily Hook is not as merciful and good natured, or as they say in the movie, good form or
bad
form.
That's a lot of the lines, that one specifically, are direct references to the original novel.
It's very indicative of like something adults would say. He pulls out another knife. There's another.
It's like Assassin's Creed knife. Assassin's comes Creed. Launching
yeah, he, like,
out of
shoots
his
it out of his fucking awesome. Like, honestly, I want to be a pirate.
Yeah, it's pretty sweet.
Early days. Yeah, it's two years before we get to Jurassic Park. Early days dinosaur. We get the crocodile with the big clock in its mouth, and like they stab, like the knife is like going everywhere between the two of them because they're kind of struggling with it, and it just absolutely caves in a part of the crocodile's stomach, which I always thought was horrifying because it like gives like paper mache, because it is.
Yeah, it's like a paper mache crocodile. Fucking crocodile. So what actually he has Peter pinned and he's gonna stab him with his hook, and then Tinkerbell flies in and grabs the hook and it deflects it into the croc.
And this wakes up the crocodile, I assume?
It starts to deflate because it's stuffed, and it falls out of its rigging and lands on Hook and eats him.
Yeah, it's unclear to me if this crocodile is alive or dead to this day.
Yeah, I don't know. I think
because it belches.
There's a little burp, and they're like, "Hook's gone." Yeah. It's a hand wavy magic thing.
I think he
really wanted that moment and was like, "Well, if I don't,
Captain Hook's got to go via crocodile."
Yeah,
that's how it happens.
Yeah,
it is how it's always been written. Mm-hmm. So I guess he's dead. He's taxidermied, but Tinkerbell takes them all back to London. Peter points the lost boy. I didn't know until
Thudbutt.
Thudbutt is his name. His name is Thudbutt. Yeah. Poor child. Poor child. And then they get back and there's a tearful goodbye.
Yeah, tearful goodbye. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And, we get we didn't mention Toodles losing the marbles and stuff, but there's a little nice little coda plant payoff of, "Oh, I found your marbles and now you can fly, you old dusty
senile
man.
Senile fucking crypt keeper asshole zooming around
apparently
London.
Is going back to Neverland to have a second childhood. But you know what's going to happen? He's going to die.
He's going to die in space on his way to Neverland.
And the lost boys are going to dump him into the sea. And he's going to get eaten by some mermaids.
Yeah, the mermaids
and
just
that's the end of
turn
Toodles.
Into horrible sirens and just like eat him. Like they grow piranha teeth.
I do think a lot about death in this movie.
I think you're meant to.
I think about like the machinations of like men fighting boys. Mm-hmm. What happens? People get stabbed. There's Rufio dies. He gets stabbed. There's no blood, of course, because they got to keep this.
Yeah, there's a
PG,
very tiny amount, but yeah. And he when he dies, he says, I wish I had a father like you. And that's, that really is another part of the theme, which is, I mentioned earlier, a movie's a lot about nostalgia, about like wanting to go back and revisit. But then, as Peter gets back, he sort of finds that he can't go back. You can't be a child again. And then also he doesn't really want to, because his happy thought, the thing that makes him fly now, is his kids. So he has to leave, and it's about looking forward. And it's also about being a parent and how, like, once you become a parent, your life becomes about your children. It's not about you anymore.
Just sticking to theme, but also kind of talking about execution. We're going to see a lot of one of the first things that I noticed in this movie. Well, actually the first thing, because it's literally the first shot. This film starts with shots of children in the audience watching Peter Pan, the play, Maggie's play. And I thought that was kind of had a point. Like, I think that Spielberg has a point by doing this before he even shows us the play. We hear audio of the play. It's just, there's like, I think 6 or 7 faces. It's just child, 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 right at their eye level. I think this is him. When I said one-to-one earlier with children in the movie, I really think that this is the movie that Spielberg is saying, like, all right, there's a bunch of stuff that's going to happen, but I'm going to I'm going to squat down to your level, kids, and I'm going to say, this is a movie for you, and this is going to be a movie about stuff that you care about. And the execution is clearly... Spielberg has always done a lot of, like, high angle, low angle to kind of, like, show different aspects of, like, oh, if it's an alien or, like, the status of, like, the scene or whatnot. But something that he almost always does, because he does have children in his movies as, like, the main, you know, people... the main actors in a lot of his films, he stays at their eye level, which is not something a lot of other movies do. Like, if you look at how Christopher Nolan shoots children versus how Spielberg shoots children, and I'm just talking about, like, pick a frame, look at the where the camera is. Is it close? Is it far? How wide is it? Is it high angle? Is it looking up or down? All these different things. There's a very particular way in which Spielberg shoots children. And it's, I think it's because he wants to, again, have this conversation with them more so than adults. It's like he's the relative that comes to your Thanksgiving and he says, like, I'm going to choose to sit at the children's table. Why? Because, like, these adults suck, right? Am I right? And they're like, yeah. You know, it's like that he wants to set up that rapport with children. And you can also hear it in his, like, audition tapes with children. When you hear him, you know, casting Elliot and E.T. in that famous kind of, like, YouTube clip. Like, he is really talking to that kid. And that is something that I think is in, not only in his wheelhouse, I think it's something that, like, he excels at. He might be the best at it on this level, for sure. And I think that this movie does a lot of the tricks that we see Spielberg do time and time again to separate the and give a different point of view for, of children.
I think that also that those opening images are also conveying that, like, how the story of Peter Pan is something that gets told to kids generation after generation. And that this is the here's me telling kids my version of the story.
One last thing I want to talk about just in terms of execution is this time I just had the random thought about, you know, we have a lot of remakes. Spielberg is pretty close to the chest about doing remakes, but eventually something's going to happen. There's probably going to be a Hook remake at some point
I think they can't wait to remake Jaws. They're just waiting for Spielberg to die.
They're just
so that
waiting.
They can remake Jaws, but, like, it's never going to, I don't think they're ever going to remake his films while he's still around.
No, I don't think they will. But I do think about what if this movie was made now. Because I saw it when I was watching, like, there's a moment of celebration between the Lost Boys. And they're doing clearly, like, dance moves that are, like, very 90s.
Oh, yeah.
You know? And I was like, oh, he's trying to be, like, cool here. Like, he's trying to make kids look cool, which is, like, you know, like Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles does it all the time. And I think about if this movie was made now, the Lost Boys would
definitely be dabbing, like, the like, flossing dance. They'd be doing all them Fortnite emotes,
the flossing dance and stuff. God damn. And then I realize how old I'm getting, because I hate that, but that's just so strange to me, is that, like, when you look back at movies in the 90s, when you were a child or I was a child, I didn't see that as, like, a gesture by an adult in order to, like, get points with kids. Now, because I have context, I see it in a like, kind of with some criticism or with, you know, some pragmatism, I guess, depending on how you look at it. And I'm like, oh, that's not cool. It's very, you know, hello, fellow kids. But, you know, that's always what Spielberg has kind of done. He always wanted to occupy that space. And in a way, I think he's more successful than most at it, because he does know what's cool, like and skateboarding and stuff.
Are less about that. Like, those elements are in it. It's more about having these conversations that are profound for kids, and I think that's why
making them have feelings, as opposed to, you know, Space Jam.
New
Space Jam. Oh yeah just tear my eyes out. I do love, there's a few other things that just on theme I did want to point out. I love that they did in this movie because they make him a lawyer, and they do a lot of lawyer jokes. But Maggie Smith, at almost the first interaction that they have, is like, so what do you do, Peter? And he's like, oh, he blows him out of the water, and like, oh, he's so good at his job, and he's a lawyer. And she goes, so Peter, you've become a pirate.
And zooms like, in on her face.
Zoom. Yeah, it's just like, ah, you got
he's
it.
A fucking
you
pirate.
Got it, Maggie Smith. So I think that the script is pretty smart in a lot of ways. There's a lot of really good, like, kind of probably on the nose. Some people might consider it sappy, but I think it's all in tune, personally, with the tone of the movie. So I don't
know. No, not at all. And I think, I mean, there was a lot of work on this script, but a lot of the dialogue's really good. And like I said, there's a lot of direct references and recalling of scenes and conversations and elements of the original novel. Like if you go and read Peter Pan, the book, and then watch Hook again, it really enhances it. Like a lot of stuff is like, oh, that's what they're talking about. Yeah. And that's what this is a reference to. And they're continuing this conversation they had 100 years ago with each other. It really becomes the script really isn't bad, except in the middle, there's some parts, which it feels like it could have even been editing, where there's a lot of like, I don't know, cutting around and stuff happens very quickly.
Mm-hmm. Since we're talking about kind of more of the minutia of it, do you want to move to the next segment?
I think
my spiel sense is tingling. So this is where we talk about behind the scenes trivia. I might talk about execution a little more because we're talking about like production notes and stuff like that. Behind the scenes stuff that we're pretty good at knowing, and maybe you'll enjoy this. This is a segment we like to call Teamwork Makes the Dream Works, SKG. That's a deep cut.
I want to
say that when we were trying to crack the chestnut that is the names of these segments, Tom was very gleeful when he thought of this one. I am a big fan of it. I'm not taking away from it, but I will just say it did warm my heart how much Tom loves
I really forced this one.
Oh, it's so good though. It's perfect, and it's what we're talking about now. So start us off, Tom.
Okay, well, this was originally supposed to be a more direct adaptation or remake even of Peter Pan that started development in the mid-80s with Spielberg attached. I think he was attached from maybe 85 to 87, like for a good while in the 80s. But he walked away from the project because his son Max was born. And he wanted, and I believe that was his first child.
Right? Kind of aptly given the content of
movie. It's very appropriate because he walked away from the film because he's like, I want to spend time with my kids. I don't want to with my new son. I don't want to be off working. And then of course that is such a huge element of what Hook is about.
Yeah, exactly. It's perfect. Wholesome as fuck, Stevie. Wasn't this planned to be originally a musical?
He did, I think, when it became Hook and he came back on board, because the project, obviously this isn't a Peter Pan adaptation. It started getting developed in that direction by Nick Castle. None other than Nick Castle. The Shape himself.
Nick Castle.
The man who plays the Shape / Michael Myers in the original Halloween, frequent John Carpenter collaborator Nick Castle was going to direct Hook.
Yep. I don't want it. I don't want it. Let's be clear. But amazing.
But I mean, like, amazing. Yeah, he was attached to the project for a while and then was basically taken off of it because he did not get along with Robin Williams or Dustin Hoffman. But Spielberg came on board and was toying around at first with doing it as a musical, and John Williams wrote all of the songs. Like he wrote, I think, 7 or 8 songs, and 2 of which are in the film. The song that the kids sing at the play and the song that Maggie sings, the When You're Alone song. Those were 2 of the songs that John Williams wrote when this was supposed to be a musical.
Yeah. Not the most memorable songs in the thing, though. John Williams always impresses. To me, the most memorable one is dun 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 dun.
Oh yeah, the Hook theme.
bump, bump, ba, da.
And yeah, the main theme of this movie, the da-na-na-na-na-na-na-na, it's like almost, he basically rips himself off later with the love theme from Star Wars Episode II. It's like the same.
Oh, yeah. John Williams is the best at that. You just know that he's just like at his piano, or he was at his piano, just looking at his own, like looking at his own, you know, notes, you know, and just being like, oh yeah, I'm so fucking good. I should steal from the best. God damn. Just horny ass.
He is John Williams. At full mast.
Quoting himself. He's at full mast, constantly quoting himself throughout his career.
Yeah, it's kind pretty of amazing. Great.
But he kind of knows what to do.
There's an interesting thing about the score here that I noticed the last few times I've watched Hook, but really didn't kind of sink my teeth into it until this time around, which is that for the first 30 minutes of the movie, you know, the first act of the film where it's just Peter and his family in the real world. And it's like, oh, it's all about what a screw up of a father he is. The score is very light and superficial and kind of fluffy. It sounds like the score to like a John Hughes movie or
especially the early stuff. Like, especially like the first half of the film.
I'm thinking of
A lot of piano. Yeah,
it sounds like when he's trying to make it to the baseball game on time. It sounds like a sitcom score, and with little bits, like little hints of the actual score to come that seep in. And then, of course, as soon as he gets to Neverland, that's when it John Williams the fuck out.
I think that there's something he's doing there.
Of course.
I think that's intentional to make like the whimsical on one side, you know, and the first kind of half or third of the movie is like mundane as fuck.
Very TV, not feeling, deep. Like it does. It's not evocative. It's very forgettable. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, when he gets into Neverland, the themes become more memorable and more evocative and more emotional. And there's this, the score to this movie is very good. I think it's one of his best ones.
Which is, it is. And kind of reflecting that back on Spielberg, an interesting notion that when you read about his thoughts at returning to this film, he's very happy with the work that he did at the beginning. Like, he's like, all the stuff that I do before Neverland, I'm very happy with. So, like, obviously choices like this. What he's unhappy with, Spielberg has argued, that he didn't feel that the technology was there. He felt like it wasn't big enough. Neverland had to feel like, I think, when Spielberg watched like Wizard of the Oz for the first time, he must have been like, it blew my mind because it like literally changed the game with color. And it's like, he was looking for something like that. And what we got was a spectacularly well-produced production designed art direction, all that stuff hitting at the highest level. But Spielberg argued that he was like, I wish I made this film with computers like CGI. He wanted it to be otherworldly.
I feel that. Like, one of my complaints about Hook is that it feels like a set. Like, Neverland's supposed to be this sprawling fantasy world, but it feels very enclosed.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, he never really got to the level of Wizard of Oz and the juxtaposition in that film, which is, I think, what he's looking for. And that's why he's kind of notoriously unhappy with this
movie. I actually
wrote
down a quote from him that's related to that I'll just say real quick. It's from a 2018 interview that he did with Empire Magazine.
Oh, cool.
And it's talking about like this middle chunk. And he says, I felt like a fish out of water making Hook. I didn't have confidence in the script. I had confidence in the first act, and I had confidence in the epilogue. I didn't have confidence in the body of it. I didn't quite know what I was doing, and I tried to paint over my insecurity with production value. The more insecure I felt about it, the bigger and more colorful the sets became. So
it's so interesting. Spielberg, just as an aside, it's so interesting how colorful he is about talking about like this is what was going on in my mind. Not a lot of directors talk about like, I was in this place. I'm uncomfortable with this. I don't like this. I feel like I could have done better here and stuff. He talks about that kind of stuff a lot. Yet he doesn't let media on his sets. One of the things that if you were to do Google search right now, you don't see set photography of Spielberg sets because he learned with Jaws very quickly, I'm not going to do that. And I'm never going to allow people to like take photos of my sets, of my construction, of all this stuff. That's why it's almost larger than life in a way, because we imagine all of the production and machinations behind this huge production, but all of it is invisible. Yet, once again, I don't know why, but just to bring up like Chris Nolan again, like everyone has seen kind of the, maybe not everyone because I'm kind of a film buff, but like a lot of people have seen like him rotating the apparatus of the hallway in Inception. Mm-hmm. You know, like some directors like you to see it all and say like, look at how impressive this show is. He doesn't.
Yeah. And like you mentioned Jaws, and a lot of people probably don't know that. Know this, but Jaws was like a production that went way, way over schedule and over mm-hmm. budget. So it was sort of like almost obsessively covered by the media. So he basically got beaten up about Jaws for a full year before it even came out.
It was a much different time where contingency was done a little differently. And it almost blacklisted him. In fact, Spielberg had in his early career a lot of issues with this. In fact, it almost killed his career a few times. Always is one of them, surprisingly. 1941, yeah. He went like notoriously over budget. And this movie, he went like $30 million over budget. So he had that relationship with studios that, were it not that his movies just slayed at the box office, he would not get to work again because he was not very good. And he was very self-conscious about it too. He was insecure about going over budget, but he definitely did it a lot.
Yeah. And I think I didn't have the notes about the set specifically, but I seem to remember, and maybe you do, I seem to remember that the sets of this film occupied something like three or four or maybe even more stages, like sound stages.
Yeah, I don't know the number, but they rented out the entire like stage system, and they like and luckily stages are built in a way that like you can kind of not take out walls, but you can move walls between stages, and that's some of, especially in London, that's some of the stages are designed that way, where it's like, oh, you're going to buy like two stages or three stages, like mm-hmm. Game of Thrones did that famously recently, where they were just like, we're going to buy this whole place and build a castle in it, basically. And with this one, it was a very large set. That's one of the reasons that everyone was, you know, talking about it, is that like it was very, very large. A lot of celebrities wanted to stop by because it was like the only production in town at that point. And there's just such star power behind it that it became kind of a thing that some people would just like stop by. And it's, you know, like all the people in 1991 that you would expect, you know, like Tom Hanks. And
Tom Hanks was originally supposed to be Peter Pan in this.
Dude, there's so many really good ones of these. Because we talked about it being a musical. It was originally going to be a vehicle for
Michael Jackson. That's
Michael Jackson,
right.
Which would have been crazy.
Bananas. And like they had, like Spielberg met with Michael Jackson. They had like conversations about it.
Uh-huh. Here's the other thing. The one that I got this time that I didn't catch like the last times that I've done a deep dive on this. For the role of Captain James Hook, David Bowie turned it down. Imagine Michael Jackson versus David Bowie. What the fuck? That's a totally different movie. I don't even know
what
to expect.
That movie would have been something else. Oh, man. Can you imagine what that film would have been? Holy shit.
Imagine.
So I looked it up. This was 9 sound stages at Sony Pictures in Culver City.
9. That is
so actually just down the street from where I lived for 5 years.
Yeah. So that's like all of Sony. That's insane. It's not all of it, but like, yeah, that's a considerable amount of that whole lot. Just for one production. That's not something that happens often.
Yeah, that many sets. And that, like, there's so many. Like, everything in Neverland is a set. I think everything in London is a set. I think everything in this movie is a set.
I think, with mm-hmm. the exception of the ball game, everything's a set. And
you can
tell, but it also has that magical, like, There's aspects of some of these sets that you go like, oh, you know who's writing this down is people who work at Disneyland. You know, the designers of the rides and the lines that you wait in. Like, everything is scripted to such an extent. And they're really good. They're highly paid. Production design teams were really top notch, and that's why this thing looks like it does. I kind of do want to say a word real quick about the photographic reason for why this movie looks like the way it does, just because I do know something about that. You may be wondering what makes the world of Neverland so magical in this movie, and you'll notice something you'll notice photographically is that all the light sources, like all the sconces, the candelabras, like the oil wick lamps and such, you know, they like bloom more, right? And you'll notice that the shine from gold and steel, like the shine of knives and, you know, just like, you know, any piece of metal that's like in it, feel more vibrant and more loud in terms of like distracting your eye. And this is done fairly simply in the camera. What they used to do is they place a thin mesh, like a fabric, on the back of the lens so that light, essentially what would happen is the photons would bleed and diffuse a little bit more. And that's why you'd get that bloom, because literally light is hitting the photo emulsion layer with a little bit more, like with a little bit more distance from the actual source. So it's not an exact one-to-one. It's like actually kind of just making it bleed a little bit more. And then that light hits the, you know, film plane. And in this era, they literally just use leggings. That would be perfect because the nice little thin threads would do a good job of dispersing the light. These days, with digital lenses, it's a little bit more precise. And they're typically, you need a like the lens to actually make a like a connection electronically with the with the camera, because they have sensors or they need to do like metadata or focus assistance or whatnot. So that convention kind of got rid of a long time ago. Now the way they do it is they just put a piece of glass in front of the lens. And it's typically called something like a black or white promist. There's loads of different flavors, but it's going from like, you know, some of them barely noticeable to like what you think of when you think of soap opera, you know, like where it really bleeds. That's what we're talking about here. And Spielberg would do this a lot. And the other technique that he'd use is in, not in camera, but in the sets. And this is probably why he got so many sets, is that he knew that in order to make things magical, and you look at things like Labyrinth, you look at things like Legend by Ridley Scott, they all worked on sets as well, because the control that you need in order to diffuse the light in a way to make it feel magical, you need to have control of that space. So a lot of stage work was done in places that looked outside in order to bring in things like, for example, a shit ton of fog. They just mist up the whole place, and they use like something called a hazer, which is like a fog machine, that would provide this aerial diffusion to make the backgrounds look more distant, more epic, more fantastical. This is just all production design teams, set directors. And once again, if you just go to like Disneyland, you'll notice that they have hazers in there. They want you to feel like you're in, you know, like Indiana Jones, so that they make these kind of haze, and you don't notice at first, but when you like take a camera and do both of these techniques that I talked about, it looks very much like something like Neverland. So I just kind of wanted to, you know,
yeah, no, it's definitely part of it. And it also kind of is a nod towards Peter Pan's history as a stage production in some ways. Because yeah, yes, like even like Grandma Wendy's like London flat, that's a set. Like even the exterior of that is a set. So yeah, the whole movie is kind of on stage, except for the scene where he drives up to the ball game and parks in a red curb, which you can't do, Peter. You're gonna get a ticket.
Yeah, but he don't got time for that. He doesn't care. But did you notice this time? I noticed that the first time we ever see Peter in his office, he mistakes the name of an intern at the that office scene. And the intern's name, we find out, is Jim. But he gets it wrong by saying Jerry, Jack, which is his son's name, right? So it's like, I thought that that was another clever, like, writing aspect, which is that they, like, Jack is just another name to Peter at this point in the screenplay. I thought that was a nice touch.
Yeah.
A lot of good writing.
Yeah, there's Carrie Fisher did punch-up work on this, I know.
She did a lot of Tinkerbell's lines. is what I read.
That makes sense.
Yeah. Also, she also has a cameo in this movie.
Did we not bring that up? I forgot that we...
Did we bring that up?
I can't remember. I she's smooching with George Lucas on the bridge when he first goes to Neverland.
I think we did it off mic, but yeah. I'll figure it out in editing. But like the idea being that on the bridge when Tink takes Peter to Neverland, they get crop dusted and they start floating up. That's George Lucas and Carrie Fisher. That's cool, I guess, you know.
Yeah, that is cool.
Yeah.
Get him in there.
Julia Roberts was notorious for having like almost a breakdown during this movie.
Yeah.
She's famously ran out of the production because she was, who's she dating? Kiefer Sutherland?
I think Kiefer at this point, she's coming right off of Pretty Woman. So she's became one of the biggest stars in the world as this film was filming.
Right. And that there's kind of a story behind she ran away and Spielberg was you ran away. I have to fire you. And they worked it out. But I thought that there was a behind the scenes story that I read that I was kind of warmed my heart a little bit, which is that she at one point was hospitalized. And Spielberg took the teddy bear from Captain Hook's cabin and gave it to Julia Roberts while she was checked into the hospital for exhaustion. And then he realized, and this is just the cutest thing though. Spielberg realized that he's oh, I need that to shoot a scene tomorrow. So he had the prop department make a lookalike in a few hours. It's just one of those cute things that he brought a teddy bear to Julia Roberts and then realized that he was making a movie. And he's I need that teddy bear, but I can't take it back. That would be mean. I'm Steven Spielberg.
I can have him make me a new teddy bear.
Yeah, exactly.
I get it. This can't be an easy role to film, but because she's tiny for every single scene in the movie except part of one, she has to film all of her stuff by herself. And you can kind of see it a little bit in her performance where obviously she's still good. She's Julia Roberts, but she does a lot of her eye line often. It's she's kind of looking around a little bit.
It's the 1,000-yard stare because you don't know exactly where you're acting. It just doesn't
look real. She looks like she's uncertain, even though she's still delivering these lines and these emotions like you'd expect Julia Roberts to. It can't have been an easy role to film.
Yeah. It most definitely not. But she's still really good at it because she's Julia Roberts. What are other things? I'm sure you had caught this before, but Rufio at one point swings his sword and stops perfectly on Peter's face, right? The easy way to shoot this, because you don't shoot that. That's
whack your star in the head, and then
you're gonna slice him in the face. What the fuck? So they did this by reversing the shot. Obviously, you hold the blade right at his face, exactly where you want it, and then you just whip it back. And it's actually a really one of the all time great performances. Like the first half of the shot when you reverse it, where he kind of he somersaults and lurches forward. And so in order to get that shot, he'd have to lurch backward and kind of do this weird jump that he does. That's hard, looks good forward, but it would be hard to do reverse because there's no cut in between those portions of the shot. So they have to, in order to keep it convincing, do that whole segment in reverse. You can tell on the tail end of the shot in the movie, he says it gets close up to his face and he says, "You're dead, Jolly Man." And the mouthing of his words is not quite good, not exact. So you can tell it's ADR. Which is just recorded after the fact. But really good performance by Rufio.
Rufio's great.
Yeah, like, that's a hard thing to do. The sword bit, which looks like the most impressive,
it's the easiest
bit, is the
thing
easy
to do. Yeah,
part.
They do it all the time.
Yeah, but lurching forward, like lurching back to make it look like you lurch forward, like jumped in space, that's, you know, gotta hand it to him.
There's one other shot that I wanted to call out that I noticed this time, and it's when it's Smee's epiphany, which is in the middle of this very funny scene between him and Hook, where Hook, you know, threatens to kill himself, and it's that funny bit where he's like, "Don't you dare try and stop me, Smee, Smee, try and stop me. What are you doing, Smee? Get over here."
Yeah, it's so good.
And so when Bob Hoskins has his epiphany, he goes like, "I've just had an apostrophe. You know, lightning has just struck my brain." The camera shifts to a Dutch angle as he's having his epiphany. Yeah. You know, because it's the power balance is starting to shift. They're figuring out a way that they can use Peter's kids against him. But it's all continuous. It shifts to the other side. Like the Dutch angle switches to kind of, it can't.
It
yeah,
can't.
Can't. That's
the
word. So it's like a ship rocking back and forth as he's having his epiphany. And it was just, I never flagged it before. And I noticed it this time. I was like, oh, that's an interesting way to do that.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. It's ship-like because it also, like, as it moves when it like hits its like end, it kind of like flops into place, kind of like when a boat, you know, moves to one side, all the stuff on the boat moves and slams into the wall, and it's this kind of like violent kind of ending.
Like as he's figuring out the idea, it settles.
Really effective. Yeah. That's really cool. I think Spielberg does a lot of that kind of stuff, and that's kind of from the old days. It's also cartoons, which we'll talk about more in different films as we get there. We're getting kind of late in this one. I feel like I could talk about Hook for another hour, honestly. But if there's any other ones you want to get through before we maybe move to our next segment.
I don't have anything
segment.
Else that I had written down.
Okay, good. Well, this one we like to close out, and this is a callback to our previous podcast that we used to do, which is, technically we're just going to read you some log lines for the film. Is that all we want to say? They're technically log lines, but we like to call this segment Close Encounters of the Word Kind.
Yeah, we do.
That's another Tom banger.
Drink that in. We can say it. They're terrible log lines.
Yeah. They're terrible log lines. That was the name of the previous thing. So we like to have a little fun here. You know, a lot of heady concepts. But here we go. Let's just like, I'll go do one. You do one. Here we go. This is Close Encounters of the Word Kind. Child murdering pirate returns to claim the tween that got away.
Oh, man. Okay. The Lost Boys get orphaned a second time.
Oh, no. A tiny fairy gets to first base with a giant, but then is rejected.
Ah, she is. Oh, man.
Just so sad.
A man blows $1 billion deal and disappears into a child's fantasy world. This whole movie could be his breakdown.
The whole movie could just be about his work.
Melting
just
down because he blew this deal.
Just loses any chances of becoming partner at his firm, you know, because his fucking dog buries his phone. A family suffers child abduction, and the father begins to believe he is actually a flying boy.
Oh, no.
Which is absolutely true. It's absolutely true.
A senile old man disappears.
Toodles. Toodles. You dumb as fuck. I love Toodles.
I just have this image of him floating into Neverland, having already died during the journey. Just his dead body floating down into Neverland.
Yeah, just decomposing
in
the water.
Huge smile on his face.
Yeah, because he's so happy that he got to where he wanted to be. An adult easily assimilates and becomes leader of a pre-existing child cult.
He would be. He would very easily overpower them.
He really just overcomes them with just words. It's harrowing.
A 90-year-old lady really wants to fuck her grandson.
Oh, hell yeah.
Oh, yes. Let's get to it. I kind of have a similar one, but I phrased it from a different perspective. An eternal demon boy, Stockholm syndromes the young women of a family line for generations.
He really does. Oh, man.
It's kind of...
that was my last one that I had.
Yeah. Then that's, I think that's a wrap.
That
then.
Is.
I think the... Well done on episode one.
We did it. We've done
Tom.
It. Spielboys in the can.
It. Oh man, this looks like it's going to be the beginning of a wonderful friendship.
A terrific one. A terrific friendship.
A terrific.
That's I'll it. Say it. I think this is going to be the best show ever made.
I agree, because it's got everything. It's got the boys, your boys.
Yeah, it does.
And it's got Spielberg.
It
Come
does.
On.
Shit.
Fuck. We're going to get...
We checked both boxes. That's all the things.
Get strapped in, because there's plenty more Spielberg where this comes from. And I also want to give a note to, if you're listening to this, this episode is being released for free on both of our networks.
Mm-hmm.
But what we're going to do is we're going to release one of these a month, and we're going to release them on kind of like if you've seen listened to our other show with our other hosts that run the things, David Bell and Michael Swaim. They have a show called Star Trek The Next Futurama, where they do a bi-weekly thing where they one for Gamefully Unemployed and one for Small Beans. We're going to do the same thing, but at the rate of one a month. And that's the kind of plan going forward, right?
Yeah, it's a joint network podcasting venture. So 1 month it'll be on Gamefully Unemployed and 1 month it'll be on Small Beans.
Right.
But you lucky ducks get this first episode for free, regardless of which channel you're going to, buddy.
Just a taste. So if you want to catch the entire run of Spielboys for the next like year or so, that will just be like, $5 to them, $5 to Gamefully, $5 to Small Beans. And you get them all, baby.
Mm-hmm.
Plus, there's a whole bunch of other stuff. So you shouldn't just do it for this.
Yeah.
I mean, we've got a lot to offer. You know, I got a song in my heart.
We've got a whole pirate chest full of booty, full of audio booty for you to listen to.
And that's kind of it. That's the rub. That's what you're getting. I think everyone's clear.
Yeah, I think we've made that clear.
This
I don't know how
getting.
To end this show.
Spielboys. Yeah, something like that. I'll find an editing.
Spielboys watching Stevie's movies. Spielboys watching Stevie's movies. Spielboys watching Stevie's movies. Spielboys.